When I look at a curve like this one, there are some places where it doesn't seem to be curving all that much. It's kind of flat, and others where it appears to be curving quite tightly. Well, how do I come up with a precise measurement of what I mean by how curvy something is? What exactly is a definition of curvature? That's the point of this video. Now, one way I can approach this problem is by looking at tangent vectors. So what I've done here is I have my curve. It's parameterized by, say, arc length. And I'm going to have some point that's going to move around this curve as my arc length increases. Then what the tangent vector has done for us in the past is it points in the direction of which the point is going. So at any particular point, the tangent vector directs where the point should go next. That's what the tangent vector does. But notice as it goes around, the tangent vector is itself moving, and we can track how much the tangent vector moves. So here's my definition of curvature. I'm going to say that the curvature kappa, this is not a k, it's a kappa, is going to be defined to be the magnitude of the change of the tangent vector with respect to the arc length parameter s. That is, as I go around my curve, as I increase my arc length, the tangent vector is going to change, and the rate of change is going to be captured by this curvature, this kappa. Now, one technical point here, notice it's the derivative with respect to arc length. Arc length is kind of a special parameter. If it wasn't arc length, if you had it parameterized by some generic t opposed to the special case of parameterized by arc length, that's fine too. It's just a little bit more complicated in that case. Indeed, if you look at what we define kappa to be, the change in the unit tangent vector with respect to arc length, well, via the chain rule, I could take instead the derivative with respect to some other parameter t, and then I'd have this dt ds floating around as well. However, we've previously seen when we were studying arc length that the velocity vector can be described as, in magnitude, as ds dt. So, provided this thing is non-zero, we can then go and say that the kappa is actually going to be 1 over the velocity vector times the derivative of the unit tangent with respect to t. So the whole point of this technical aside is to say that if you have your unit tangent vector expressed in terms of arc length, great, you get the simpler top formula. But if your curve is given in terms of some other parameterization, some other parameter t, that's also totally fine. It's just you have to divide out by the velocity when you go and compute your curvature. Let's see an example. This curve expresses the circle of radius a. And what my guess here is that if I have a really big circle, then its curvature is going to be quite small. If I have a really small circle, a sort of tighter one, then its curvature is going to be larger. Sort of loosely corresponds to the idea that if I'm driving at a fixed speed and I go around a tighter curve, I feel more g-force than if I go around a shallower curve. All right, so let's do some computation. Now, this is with respect to t, just some generic parameter here. And I'm going to compute the velocity, which is the derivative of this position vector with respect to t. It's going to be minus a sine t in the i-hat direction and a cosine of t in the j-hat direction. So that's the v vector, thus its length, which is going to be the square root of the first component squared plus the second component squared. Well, sine squared plus cos squared is 1, so what I have is square root of a squared, so it's just going to be equal to a. The length of the velocity vector is the radius. Next up, the unit tangent vector, which is the velocity divided out by its length. That's the difference between the unit tangent and the velocity. They're aligned, but the unit tangent has unit length. So what do? I just cancel out the a here, and I get this minus sine of t in the i-hat and the cosine of t in the j-hat. Okay, what's next? I need to take the derivative of the unit tangent vector with respect to t. And, well, I can do that perfectly fine. Minus sine t, its derivative is going to be minus cosine, and cosine is going to go to minus sine. And finally, I need to take the length of that. So let me take the length of dt dt, kind of funny to say it, d capital T, d lowercase t. Well, again, sine squared and cos squared is equal to 1, so if I take the square root of the sum of the components, I just get 1. All right, I've computed what I need to, so I can just plug it into my formula, and I get that kappa, the curvature, which is 1 over the velocity times the length of dt dt. This is just going to be 1 over a times 1, or 1 over a. Note this matches my prediction. If you have a really big radius, if a is really large, then your curvature is quite small. It's a very flat curve, kind of like the curvature of the Earth that looks pretty flat from our perspective on it. However, if you have a really small curve, then 1 over a is much larger and you have a bigger curvature. The next thing I want to study is something called the principal unit normal. If the curvature was a magnitude that told you sort of how much this thing was curving, then the principal unit normal tells you in which direction it is curving. So what I've done here is I put my tangent vector and it's moving around as it had done before. But what I'm also doing is putting this principal unit normal to the tangent vector. And what it's doing is it's telling you where is the tangent vector going. At any point, it's the direction in which the unit tangent vector is going to change as you increase your arc length. Now, this normal vector is indeed a unit because the length of this dtds was defined to be the curvature kappa. So I've taken its length and I've divided it up. So for sure it has unit length. I am going to skip one detail for you. I'm going to skip the proof that this normal is indeed a normal. It's a technical addition that follows from the fact that I am taking the derivative of a unit vector. Nevertheless, I get a principal unit normal. All right, one more concept for this video. I want to talk about circles of curvature. Same picture I had before. I've got my tangent vector and I've got my unit normal. But now what I'm doing is I am drawing at any point a circle of curvature. And the idea of my circle of curvature is that a circle of curvature is a circle that has the exact same curvature as the curve has at a particular point. So if you watch as this goes around, sometimes the circle of curvature is big, sometimes the circle of curvature is small, and it reflects whether the curvature at that point is big or whether the curvature at that point is small. We have the additional condition that this circle of curvature is tangent to the curve. So it's kind of like a tangent line, but now it's a tangent circle where the curvature is going to match. And the normal vector is always going to point towards the center of that circle of curvature. Finally, I want to add that my circle of curvature is on the concave side, not the convex side, just to have one chosen at any particular point. Now, in this video, we restricted our analysis to curves on the plane. Everything is two-dimensional here. In the next video, we're going to upgrade. We're going to go to three dimensions. And for example, if there is a plane defined by the tangent vector and the normal vector, there's going to be a question, well, how much does the curve tilt off of that plane? We need to do that three-dimensional analysis. That'll be in the next video. If you have a question about this video, leave it down in the comments below. We're all mathematicians here. We appreciate algorithms, so let's just help the YouTube algorithm out by giving this video a like. And finally, if you want to watch more multivariable calculus videos, this video is part of a larger playlist on multivariable calculus, so you can check out those videos here, and we'll do some more math in the next video.